We started cover crops in 2013, the year of the prevent plant. We learned a lot of the new terminology and some of the species, and you just continue to add species to it, whether it be kale or whether it be winter peas or whether it be some sun hemp, oats, radishes, turnips, triticale, rye. There's getting to be more and more things out there. If you use them right, you can get not only forage value out of them, you can get fertilizer value out of them for nitrogen. But I think the biggest thing is water quality and soil holding capabilities. You can't stress enough how we just don't see that real erosion that we used to see when you're doing tillage. It just hardly even exists anymore. The ability of that ground to take water is probably what we've seen the greatest benefit. And I'll admit, no-tilling has been a challenge. We built a new planter in 2016 specifically for no-tilling. So we've got a lot of attachments and that on it you normally probably wouldn't have, but it's very functional. This field of corn right here was planted with that planter simply because we can put nitrogen on it at the same time as we plant. And that's the big thing. There's no-till coulters on it. There's seed firmers on it. There's hydraulic down pressure. We've got all the tools on it, and it really works well. Very happy with it. The more years we no-till, when you go and dig up a shovel full of dirt, you will notice that ground is more crumbly, and you'll notice the pore space in it. And that's mainly from worms and stuff like that. So that ground to me is taking a lot more water. It doesn't seem like our waterways are getting the workout today that they used to be years ago. And I think that's telling me that where that water is falling, it's pretty well staying there and percolating into the ground. This will be the fourth year on this particular field that we've gone completely to a no-till type situation where in the spring, we just come back in with the planter with residue managers on, and we wipe away that residue. I think it's gotten easier since we've adopted cover crops. We're seeing that sometimes you will have wetter conditions that you're planting into. And as we use cover crops, we're not seeing that crusting activity. You know, if you get a hard rain after you plant, it seems like you'll have a little bit of a crust, but it's much, much thinner, and beans and that don't have an issue of coming up through it, especially if you have some spots in the field that maybe are a little bit wetter than what is ideal. So that's been a plus. The economics of moving to less tillage, I think, are fairly obvious. The fact that you don't need the full width equipment, the fuel, the tractors, and that. But I think there are some challenges when you first move to it, because I think the first year is probably the most challenging. When you do full width tillage, the ground has kind of a Play-Doh type texture to it. And as you get into a no-till 1, 2, 3, 4 years down the line, you'll see where the soil becomes more of a honeycomb, more of an angel food cake type texture to it. And it has the ability to absorb water. And when it gets to be that way, it's easier to seed into, it's easier to plant into. As far as the economics of it go, it costs us roughly $20 to $25 an acre with seeding costs and seed to put down a cereal rye. And you can offset that by the lack of, you're not chopping stalks in the fall, you're not doing deep tillage work, you're not doing spring tillage work. And I think those more than offset just the cost of the seed. And now that we've been into it for 4 or 5 years, we are taking a real hard look at starting to back our nutrients down. We'll know more when we take our soil tests. If our levels are staying up there because we're not burning the carbon up, we have residue in the ground. The residue in the ground obviously is holding nutrients. As that crop season goes on, those nutrients are breaking down. I believe that those nutrients, when they do break down, are coming more at an opportune time of grain fill. We're just not seeing the weed pressure that we used to see. And I believe this is the cover crop, is that competition is there. And I believe the cover on the ground also, and the fact that you're not stirring it, you're not creating that perfect environment. I mean, I've been at this for 43 years, and what I've learned the last 10 years, had I known that 30 years ago, things would have been entirely different. I think the number one thing is, if you're interested in no-till and if you're interested in soil conservation, if you're committed to it, go on out to field days, ask questions, find out what people are doing, look at equipment. I can't stress it enough. It's a mindset to make it work.
NRCS's point of view on the thing was,
They were telling us how much soil loss we had. You know, and I don't think a lot of people understand, you know, a dime's thickness across an acre is a ton or better. And I don't think we understand that, you know, as you see that. And you see a small gully come across the field, you really don't have an idea of how they measure that. And but it amounts to substantial tons. I think that's probably where NRCS got us most involved with it, is they were able to put that thing into perspective as to really how much soil loss we were having and why we were having it. So I think that's saying, well, you know, can we do better? So that's one of my standard questions to people when, if they have, you know, soil erosion issues, is that the best you can do? If you got some pretty good gullies across the field, you ask a person, is that the best you can do? They're not really not proud of that. You know, no, I think I can do better. Well, what are you going to do next? And they got to start thinking about this process. And I think we're definitely seeing less weed pressure. This year, we used a post-emergence herbicide on our corn, and we never went back in and sprayed it. And we have very, very few weeds out there. We have very little coming up with giant ragweed or anything like that. I mean, I've been very impressed with it. And it looks like corn yields are going to be very respectable this year. Soybean meals look like they're going to be very respectable. And given some of the land that we farm, we had pretty timely rains on. Some of the land that we have up there where we live at Pine Island, we went for about 4 weeks there with no rain. And that's a little more of a lighter texture, granular type soil. And I felt the no-till ground where we had to cover crops really handled it well. The corn held a good green color. It didn't really roll up. So I think there was definitely some advantage there to keeping that cover on the ground. We've got a farm right up the road here where we tiled it in 2013. And of course, with all the traffic in and out of there, we had a tremendous amount of compaction. And we planted rye in there in the fall 3 years in a row now, and you can't even tell where those tracks are anymore. And we never went in and deep tilled it or anything like that. That to me is a better tool than using any kind of iron to break up hardpan. I think no-till has its place, cover crops has its place. You get those teamed up together, and I think you can have a very, very functional program on a small scale and even on a large scale. But it's just how you go about it. You got to have a plan. You got plan A, you got a plan B, and you might even want to think about plan C, because Mother Nature sometimes is going to throw that at you. I think it's exciting. I think the cover crop thing, even at my age, I mean, every year, every day, you read something new, you get new ideas, and I think it's an exciting time in agriculture. I mean, I would encourage anybody, if you haven't stepped on that cover crop bandwagon, even from a soil erosion standpoint, take a small field and see what you can do with it. I think you'd really be impressed. I think it's definitely a step in the right direction.